Okay, so welcome to this evening session. It's a pleasure to welcome Professor Ajay Sood here. This is going to be a talk which will be followed by dinner. But really, it's a sort of talk that we should have had as an after-dinner talk with appropriate libations to precede it. as you will see as we go along. But to introduce Professor Ajay Sood, he's a physicist, currently and has been for much of his professional life at the Indian Institute of Science. He got a degree in physics, a master's degree from Punjab University in Chandigarh, and then proceeded to do a PhD in IISc while managing to avoid being on IISc campus for much of his tenure. That's a separate conversation you might want to have with him as to how you can manage to do that. But he's since been at IISc, where he's now a professor in the Department of Physics. In the course of many years there, he has accumulated so many awards and distinctions that if I were to go through the list, dinner would be delayed, so I shall not do that. And instead merely mention that he's a member of all three academies here. Padma Shri, has the Bhatnagar and G.D. Birla Awards, and also a fellow of the Royal Society. He's also been on the Scientific Advisory Council for the Prime Minister, not the current Prime Minister, but he has been the Prime Minister, advised the Prime Minister from 2009 to 2014. He's worked on a whole range of stuff. I really don't know how he manages to do it, because I see that he's worked on good stuff like micelles, vesicles, and membranes, but also on not so good stuff like DNA. He's done a lot of, he's used spectroscopy, largely Raman spectroscopy, to investigate properties of materials, going to the extent of squeezing stuff between diamond anvils to really beat the stuff out of, yeah. And he has done a whole range of interesting things, but what he's going to talk about today is something, at his induction, or prior to the induction to the Royal Society, he talked about flocking behavior and how a physicist studies flocking behavior, and just about everybody who heard him at that meeting raved about it afterwards. So I thought we really should have him over so that NCBS could rave about him at slightly shorter remove. Professor Ajay Sood.
It's on. Can I just show it? Thank you, Professor Matthews, for this very kind introduction. In fact, it's a great pleasure for me to be here. And I'm also a little bit apprehensive at this stage to talk to specialists here from for a total outsider. You will see what flocking means for us. So I would like to thank you for being bold enough to have me this evening and listen to what we have been playing around in the lab for fun. And when I saw the title of your symposium, or whatever annual talk you call, The Coming of Age, it really hit me that this is indeed coming of age. Because not many years ago, I know biologists who were bold enough to listen to outsiders and really tolerate them. So I really thought it has made a transition, and this really fits the title of your symposium. So I thought maybe that's the reason Professor Matthews want to have me there. So thank you very much. So the message is very clear that I want you to forget all the complexities of biology, which you have been listening for the last almost 24 hours. I just want you to do nothing, sit back and relax, and see what fun can be if you were doing physics. So, all right. So my talk will tell you about flocking. I'll define this active matter. It's a physics-y term from a physicist perspective. So let me first acknowledge the people who really contributed to this study. Nitin, who was a graduate student with me and Shriram. Harsh, who was a graduate student of Shriram. And I'm so glad Shriram is here from Hyderabad. We were doing this together. So what happened about 2 days back when I was preparing, thinking of this talk, I did some cheating. So I thought flocking may be too much because you may just get fed up with it. So I thought in the last 10 minutes, I'll tell you something very new, which I'm talking for the first time here, where we have made a micro-size heat engine using bacterial activity. So what it means and what it can tell us. So I thought I'll share some of the key results. Not that we understand all of it, but that in the last 10 minutes. So that work is done with my graduate student Sudish, Rajesh from JNC, Shubho and Dipankar from Molecular Biology Unit of ISC. So this, when I was also preparing, this article appeared on 7th January 2016, and it really said what my title of the talk could have been. It said the physics of life, and if you read, it exactly means what I want to tell you. From flocking birds to swarming molecules, physicists are seeking to understand active matter and looking for a fundamental theory of the living world. What a statement. So I'm sure some of you will be skeptical, but that's not I am saying. This is what the popular article on 7th January issue is saying. So this is what picture here is what is a murmuration, a collection of starlings. This is from the YouTube, and you must have seen in the sky that you can see these birds forming beautiful flocks. Do you need to switch off or it can be seen? I just want to show the source. This is the person who has taken and uploaded this video. Okay. So let's move on. So this was one example of flocking. So by active matter, you all know what we mean. One example, of course, is the E. coli run and tumbling motion. And there are many, many examples which physicists put under this broad title of active matter. So by active particles, what we mean are these are self-driven out of equilibrium, where the energy is input at particle level, and the direction is determined by internal coordinates rather than external field. And there are many examples. For example, kinesin motors moving on the appropriate platform. You have animals, fish, birds, bacteria, molecular motors, and more important for physicists is the last set of examples which have become quite popular in the last 10 to 15 years, namely chemical or mechanical imitators. So in our experiments, what we are using are this polar granular rods, which have asymmetry. So they have a distinct head and a tail, and we vibrate, we put them on a platform which is vibrated, and then we see what is the interesting thing. So there are many things which happen in this active matter other than flocking. I'll just mention it to tickle some of you if you want to look at this when you go out, where you can have so there are many nice things. If you look at the number fluctuations in these systems, usually the number fluctuations are under root n, but here the fluctuations is as large as n. You can have interesting phase transitions, you can have pattern formation, you can have wave propagation and oscillations in absence of inertia, and very interesting mechanical and rheological properties. So flocking is a collective motion of living organisms by sensing each other's presence, orientation and direction of movement. So there are many examples, which I showed one of them. Here is the example of E. coli swarm. You have the ant mills going around, and this is what motivated our experiments. And you can also read this PRL, very respected journal in physics, if you have doubts. And this talks of this mosh pits in heavy metal concerts, and you will see that active matter, which are not too small, are performing this beautiful flocking. So you can download this video from the supplementary material. And what is the physics behind the human beings? You can just read that. So it's a very fascinating field. Okay. So in general, if you really want to see flocking, there is a very critical thing which you have to remember, that it is an emergent behavior arising from very simple rules followed by individuals. So there is no central coordination, there is no director, no head which really directs the individuals. It is an emerging phenomena arising from simple rules followed by individuals. And this indeed was looked at. The earliest model for understanding this was given by Craig Reynolds, and this program you can download, it's called BOIDS, it can run on a PC, which simply said that what is the minimal model to get flocking in all these examples I showed you. So first you have separation, so you avoid crowding neighbors, short range repulsion. Then you bring some coherence, steer towards average position of neighbors, and then you do the alignment, namely steer towards average heading of neighbors. And this, you can read more about this program, and this gives you more or less the flocking in all these living objects, which I referred in my few slides back, in some minimal model you can give. So there are a lot of approaches to understand flocking. This is the one I started with, and there is a very famous and celebrated model by Wiechek, 1995 in PRL. I'll just show you. Then Toner and Wu, too, and then other papers and so on. And this field has been evolving much more rapidly now than in the earlier years. So this is the Wiechek model, which says, which he showed with very simple rules by looking at this individuals and with some noise, showed that if you put lot of them together, you can really get the flocking which is seen. And if the noise is number density is less, like here, then you don't get flocking. And this is the Wiechek model, which really looks at the nearest neighbor interaction and then goes on to predict this. So this was 1995. So what are we doing in this field? So our approach was to take inanimate objects and see what is the minimal model, which minimum system we can have to look at the flocking, and is it different than the models we already know. So first we thought we'll take an individual particle. We need to understand human individual first and then go to put many of them together. So the experiment is extraordinarily simple, actually. So what we do, we have a shaker which shakes this plate about less than a millimeter, 0.1 millimeter in fact, and you put some particles. I'll show you in detail. This is our active particle, which has a head and a tail, And put you can also put spherical particles, which will not move because they are not asymmetric. So what we do in this setup, we put the shaker, you have a high speed camera, and record the movies and have fun. That's a simple experiment. So what you do here, you vary the amplitude and the oscillation frequency, and this amplitude is right 0.02 to 0.05 millimeter. So very, very small oscillation at a frequency of about 200 hertz. And you can now define how much acceleration you are giving with respect to gravity. So it's a dimensionless parameter. I will not elaborate, but we work around 6 to 7 in this parameter space. So here, just to recall, what is the equivalent in the other objects in this inanimate thing? So the energy is given from the vibrated surface. So that is like a nutrient or fuel, like the ATP which you give to cells and bacteria. Tilt of the particle is like a motor coordinate, and direction of motion of this object is set by the particle orientation and not by an external force. So this is what defines our system. So let me just show you that they do move. So what we have done in this track, one-dimensional track, I put a symmetrical particle. This is a brass rod, length of about 4 millimeter, diameter is less than a millimeter, very simple objects. You can see that we are vibrating now, but this is not moving too much. It is just wiggling around their equilibrium position. But now if I take an asymmetric object, which is here, head and a tail, then you can see it's here, it's probably not moving. You can see that it is moving. Can you see this? But not too much. And now I put another object which is more asymmetric, and now you can see that this is really moving like a horse in a track, very fast. And you can plot mean square displacement, and indeed the displacement is proportional to time. So this is something which we are calling the active particles, and the energy is coming from the this thing. And now if I put a single particle on a plate, you can see that it moves. And now we want to play around with this. So the shape really matters. Supposing I have a shape like this, you will realize that this is moving somewhat like E. coli. You see, run and tumble, run and tumble. So if you plot the velocity distribution, you have a tumble and the run motion. So now you can play around with the shape, and you can decide what kind of activity you want. So now what we do, we put this particle. First we see, let's put it in a crowd and see what happens. So this is a very simple experiment. We put the spherical beads in which we put a single rod, just one rod, and want to see how it moves. So what will be your guess? Okay, it will move forward. And sure enough, it moved forward, but with a small surprise. The surprise is, if you plot the velocity versus time, you can see that on the average it is moving forward, but there are large negative events. So it's not simply moving like this, it's moving back, moving forth, moving back, moving forth, and so on. So our first question was, is it just noise? Or is there some sense in this? And you'll be surprised, there is a lot of sense in this actually. And the sense is, now you ask, what is the statistics of these fluctuations, which are negative events? Why is it going back? It is going forward in the crowd, but it also moves back. So is there a sense? And for that, I'll just mention a very powerful theorem, which probably, if we plot probability distribution, if there was no medium, no spherical beads, it's mostly positive. But now if you put in the bead, as I said, you have huge negative velocity as well as positive velocity. So we want to understand that. That was our first surprise in this field. Now this is a very powerful theorem, which you know, that in thermodynamics we always say heat flows from hot to cold, which means you will say that this entropy production is positive. But you can always ask, and there is nobody who can stop you, what is the probability that you will have a heat flow from cold to hot, which is what we don't usually talk about. Because on the average, you have this direction, but at short times, with the fluctuations, when the fluctuations are large, nobody can stop heat going from here to here. And the, what is the probability of these rare events was given by a very powerful theorem. I will not go into detail, only flash it, that this theorem is called fluctuation theorem. It is by Galavotti and Cohen, and it is the probability of actual, I mean the common sense events divided by probability of rare events is exponential in this time as well as the amount of entropy production rate. So on the average, everything is fine. Second law of thermodynamics, nothing wrong, and you live happily ever after. But you have to remember, at short times or short systems, small systems, when the fluctuations are large, you can have these rare events. Now, the importance of this theorem in NCBS is the following, and that's why I thought I should mention it, that this theorem is intimately related to Dzerzhinsky equality, and this has been used to understand that if you have some biological state, for example of DNA in state A, you take it to state B. If you want to find out what is the free energy difference between these two states, you have no way except this equality. So what you do, you go from state A to B by various trials, which is WI, and if you take an average, it exactly gives you delta F. And in fact, this has been used very effectively in biological systems to estimate delta F going from state A to state B. And that is why I thought it's interesting that this theorem, which we started worrying about, and indeed we found, we did the probability distribution of positive and negative events, no details given here, but at the end of it we showed indeed it is valid, which is a big surprise because this theorem has been given for entropy production rate. But what we are doing is the velocity of a particle. So so there is a lot of issues, unanswered questions, but the message I want to leave and move to flocking is that even one particle behavior is very exciting. Now let's come to collective motion. And collective motion, as I showed, this is the video which inspired us. This is the of this this is from this paper. So from disorder to order in marching locus. So they showed that if you put this locus in that ring and you increase their density, increase their number density, up to a certain density, everyone is moving randomly, no correlation. After a certain density of this concentration, they start moving in a very, very organized manner. They can move left to right or they can move right to left, but they move collectively. So there is a transition going from completely disordered phase like the drunkard to a collective phase like in a flock. So this is what was in 2006, and they put the V-check model to see that, look, this is another example of V-check model. Now what do we do? Now inspired by that, we put our particles, now many of them, on a plate and vibrating them. Can you see any coherence? I can't. Actually, there is none. It's all random. Now we put, because now these particles have no way to talk to each other, because there are few of them, they are objects which are not communicating. So now we put a communication link between them. We put the beads now in between. So we have the spherical beads and the particles. So I will be calling beads and rods. Rods means active particles. So now you see, still there is something happening at short time, some two or three get together, but not a long time sustainable flock. So what we did, we slightly increased the number of rods, and now you see beads and rods, here it is beads, add more, and now you can see that beautifully in very short time they have a collective motion. So this is the transition we are talking from no flocking to a flocked behavior. So as a physicist, you always have to quantify things. So we can quantify the order parameter, namely what is the orientation of this particle. We can do that, and then we can show that indeed if you build From here, you can just look at the numbers. I want you to read the numbers. It may not be so visible. The area fraction of the beads is 41%, and the rods are only 6%. 6% rods in a crowd of 41% bead. It's incoherent. There is no order. Here, we have increased the beads to 68%, and the rods is still 5%. Only 5% rods. You can now see that soon they will get into an ordered phase, and you can quantify the order parameter as a function of time, and this is the saturated behavior, which means they remain flogged all time to come. Only thing is the whether the it is left to right or right to left, it depends on the fluctuation. So half the time when you do experiment, it can be one way, and other way it half the time it can be other way.
The wall change shape, does that matter?
Pardon?
The wall change shape.
Okay. So here the shape, I did not say it, but I just say it, that this is meant to avoid the flocking or the crowding at the boundaries. So when we don't do that, they go there and cannot get out. And that inspired another problem of the trapping, which I'll talk in a few minutes. So the wall is made this because we do not want the particles to get stuck here if it was completely circular. And this shape, which is not our idea, which is followed from the literature, that they had used this shape to show the avoiding. So it was a empirically designed shapes which gave rise to no flocking, concentration at the ends, but only this collective motion is what we are studying. So now you can draw a phase diagram, because you want to know how many beads and how many rods I need to put. It's not a unique combination. There's a whole lot of values possible. These are all the experiments. So you can see that Nitin has explored a huge parameter space. So 5 beads, area fraction, and the rod area fraction. So you can see that for 10% rods, you start seeing even at 45% beads a ordered behavior. So you can see a beautiful phase diagram, which tells you that it's a huge parameter space which is available by playing with the beads and rods. And this is something you can do many things. I will not discuss this part. This is where you start getting jamming and so on, and really very less action. So we will avoid this discussion and only focus across this. So physicists have a kind of a compulsion to ask, is it like a phase transition? And you know, you can't avoid this question. You plot appropriate correlation functions and see if there is anything happening near the phase boundary in the diagram I showed. Indeed, things are happening, but all the issues of finite size and so on have to be put in before you start calling it a phase transition. So I will not spend time on this, but go on to explain what is the rule of the bead medium. Is it important? Answer is yes. And right, almost always near the boundary.
Even for large.
Yeah, yeah. I'll show you some more interesting things. So here, what we are asking now, what is the role of the beads? So what we have done is, now beads also we look at, individual beads, and plot their velocities. Because this you can do, once you have the image, you can do everything with the image. So now we plot the velocities, and find when the rods are moving incoherently, actually there is no correlation. So the rods and beads, they are going hand in hand in terms of the coherence of the motion. But now when you see when there is a beautiful order of the beads, namely the flock, if you look at the beads also, you look at the not very obvious, there are arrows here, and there are, which is the magnitude, the size of the arrow. I can't explain all the details, but beautifully you see a highly ordered motion of the beads also. So beads were inactive, they were boring, but now by the presence of the rods, they have started becoming good actors. They are also now doing in unison, and there is a beautiful collection or a collective motion which is coming. So you can again quantify the bead order parameter, rod order parameter appropriately, and show that indeed they go hand in hand. So when the beads become, when the rods become flocking, beads also show very interesting coherent motion. So this is something which we understand, that beads have a very important role to understand this dynamics. So now you can also watch how a wandering rod, which is very much away, this is almost, you can see 5 diameters apart, huge distance, it's not at a small distance. You will see, if you take the snapshots, you can see that slowly, if you move here, this rod starts feeling the motion of the beads and really comes and joins the flock. So moving rod leads to bead flow, and the resulting bead flow aligns the nambric rods. So it's a beautiful synergy. So it is when the rod is moving, it is churning the beads, and those churning really telling other rods what to do, and that's how the flock forms. And it is not a nearest neighbor between the rods. It can be very far away, but this churning or the collective motion of the beads really does the job. And this is where the Harsh and Shriram come in. So they make, this is the real rod, this is Harsh rod by joining the spheres, 1:1, whatever we have, they generate that. And again, it is time driven simulations, you take care of all the bouncing from the things, but you also include rotational noise in the particle dynamics, which is a must, because all our rods are not same. So it's not just a very perfect jumping up and down. It is really with some degree of variability, you put that as a noise, and sure enough, they beautifully show on the left hand side, it is the flower geometry, what experiment is, it's a disordered phase, but now you increase this phi B and phi R, and you can see this is simulation, not experiment. It looks so much like experiment, it's beautiful. The red ones are the beads, and these are the rods, and you can see them go into the flock state. Now the beauty of this is that theories are not constrained by what happens in real world. So this is the beauty of theoretical physics, and they excel in that. So what you can now do, you need not play with this boundary which somebody asked. Now you can do any boundary, you can do anything, which experimentalists we take years to put into action. So people like Shriram, Madan and so on, they are like gods, you know, they play around with this thing. So what will they do? They put a periodic boundary condition, not the finite system, but infinite system in with the periodic boundary condition, and you can show that the, in less number density there is disorder, and when you increase the appropriate number density, you definitely see you will see the collective motion, and this will not be like a circular motion which somebody asked. So this is really with no boundaries, the simulation in the periodic boundary condition sense. So this is the beauty of the simulation. So it not only mimics this flower geometry, but now you can play around with this. And now comes Shriram's hand to see what is the minimal model to explain this. I will just show only one slide without, because this is an evening talk, and I was told showing equations is forbidden. In spite of that, I'll show this because Shriram will be offended if I don't show. He is in the audience, so I have to show this. So with your taking this risk and being thrown out of NCBS very soon, let me just show what we do are the writing the equations. So you have the polarization of the rod, namely the orientation, you have the velocity field of this beads, you couple it, essentially one is promoting the other one, and there is a feedback. So with the minimal model, you can show indeed there is a parameter space where you will have a phase transition. Not that we do the whole phase diagram, but this minimal model predicts that you will have a transition from disordered state to an ordered state. So that was so much for theory. And now you can ask many questions. Actually, there is no dearth of questions, because yes, can we do at the little later, because I have some few more things which I may run out of time, but I'll catch up with you in few minutes after that. So there are many interesting things you can ask. actually. So the equations are simply writing the coupling between these two variables and feedback. So here we show these beads which we have shown you. They were actually nice one single diameter. So it forms a crystalline state and all that. So we said, is that necessary? Answer is no. You can put anything which communicates. We have put two diameter beads. They are not in any ordered state. And still the same thing happens and you get a flocking. So the beads geometry or their structure is not really that important in deciding this cooperative state. So let me summarize this part because I have said a few things. So let me summarize. So this experiment was just to demonstrate that you can form a flock in the collection of dry grains. Very simple experiment, just by shaking, giving them energy, making them move, and collective motion is a flock. So a small concentration of motile particles, which is the rods, can coherently transport a large passive cargo, which this is the part I will amplify a little later, that even the beads, which were so boring and so lethargic earlier, have also become now very active. They are also doing the collective dance, and that's what is the synergy between beads and rods, which is playing out. Now, what else can you do? Many, many things, actually. This is just a very small subset of things we have done and still doing. Can they form swarms, which was shown by Hirsch? Yes, you can form. What happens if, can you trap these particles in some obstacles? And if you can trap, can you do something interesting with them? And can you sort out various activity particles, not by their size, but by activity, not by the molecular sieve or any sieve, but by activity? So this is the questions, these are the questions we asked. So here it shows you that now what, this is the experiment done by an undergrad student, summer student from ISER Trivandrum. So he was with us, with me in last summer. And what he has done is, motivated by Hirsch simulation, we put in this, sorry, it's not very clear. Can you see we have beads and rods? This is the total area fraction, and it is half rods, half beads. Okay, oh, thank you. Just only 2 minutes before they go to sleep, I'll just wake it up. So this is 0.26. And now if you do the movie, actually, you will see there will be very little collective motion. Rods and beads are moving not in any way, but cut the story short. After you cross total area fraction of 0.3, some things happening, and you form really this very large swarms which live for long. And they break, they form again, and they are taking the beads along with them. So there is a beautiful motion of these beads and rods in the right parameter space when you have not gone to the fully ordered state. This is just close to the boundary of this order disorder. And you have very interesting swarms forming. And this is something, again, which, can I have the slides, light, please? So you can take a snapshot and you can show that the swarms are much bigger as you increase the area fraction of these rods and beads. Now, the second fun game, how do they behave when I put a trap? And this was motivated again by a simulation, Helmut Sloan, and an experiment on bacteria. So what they showed was that if you put a trap, you can see the trap here, and if you vary the angle, it matters. So what they showed in the simulation, and we showed in our experiment, that if the angle is less than 120 degrees, then all these active particles which were outside, they were moving, with time they will simply accumulate inside. So you have a complete trapping of this at less than 120 degrees, the 80 degrees, with time they will all come and assemble. But if it is more than 120 degrees, they will never assemble. They will keep on going in and out. And so it means there is a detrapping to trapping transition as a function of the angle of the obstacle. And this, again, some lot of fun things I will not mention. Lot of things happen, and what happens near the angle when it is just between these two, and so on. And this is some, again, the dynamics of these events, again very interesting. Now we put two types of active particles. We have this, our favorite one, and now I put this run and tumble particle, which I showed you moves like E. coli. Now I put them in between, in a trap which is less than 120 degrees. So what do you expect now? It should have been color coded. What happens is, in few minutes, few seconds, only this particle which is active gets trapped. This particle does not get trapped. So both are active. So this is an activity based sorter. So this tells us that there may be fun in trying these experiments with different bacteria. Supposing you take different bacteria and put a trap. People have shown in one experiment that one type of bacteria gets trapped. You can concentrate the bacteria if they are flowing in a tube, and you can form them. And what happens if you have different types of cells? Can you have this sorter based on the activity? And this can be a fun game to play with. So here there is a small anecdote and a story. So I thought I'll tell you, after we wrote this paper, it appeared in many places. And one place where it appears is Deccan Herald, you know, the most famous newspaper in Bangalore. And this paper gave a title, I hope you don't fall out of your seat. It said, IFC experiment may provide solution to stampede. Now, why this happened is a small story. So when this paper appeared, this journalist called me. And he said, oh, why everyone is talking so much about this? What is so great? I said, there is nothing great. So he said, no, why everyone is so excited? What is the application of this idea? I said, what application? This is total fun. No application, zero use for humanity. So he will not trust me. He said, no, sir, how can you be supported by government without being anything useful? But I said, go to NCBS, they are doing the same. What is wrong? When they can do, I can also do. But he won't believe. No, they said, sir, they are DAE people, they can do anything. So, but in your university, you have to do something useful. So out of desperation, and believe me, it was desperation, I said, because 2 days before, Bihar stampede had occurred. Before this appeared in the, so I said, maybe I was thinking of something, and I said, maybe our experiments can help to understand stampede. I just said it without doing any experiment or anything, and next day this appeared. So actually you should read it, it is fun. So when you are bored, you should read what journalists can do and this thing. So now this motivated us to really do something on stampede. Because I thought this will be, and here I realize it's a very, very beautiful literature of clogging in bottlenecks, whether it is the roads, whether it is the grains coming through a hopper, whether it is microparticles, immobilization, panic flow, in here it is sheep, but it could be you and me. All this really is happening in the studies which people are doing. And what people do in this one experiment which I have taken here, they are the sheep and they want to study flocking, stampede. And what they do is, they put through the door, sorry, I didn't have the slide, they put the door and put the sheep. So they are varying the size of the door and the number of sheep. Exactly like if there is a stampede here, you will all rush. Now I hope the architect has designed these doors correctly. If not, NCBS will be in trouble. So the idea is, in architect this thing, what is the size of the door, optimal door without wasting space, and for the number of people who are in the hall. And this is where this study is come useful. And what we have done now, in this particular experiment, I make a hole which is like a door and put for the same diameter of the door, 1.85 times the diameter of the rod, I vary n. And sure enough, you can show that with 100 active particles, there is no stampede. With 200, there is almost stampede because everyone is trying to go out. And when you do a devariation, you can again show there is a beautiful phase space where there will be a stampede and where there will be no stampede. So the idea here is replace human beings and sheep with this inanimate objects who will not hurt you, and see what is the minimal understanding of this jamming. And that's the idea of these experiments. Actually, I'm running out of time, right? 5, 7, 10, okay. Okay. So this is the kind of things we did. So I'll just put this in the right, some perspective of what else is happening in this field. So it's not that people are interested in flocking, collective behavior in active matter and so on. And I found this paper very fascinating. There are many other papers. What they have done is they have put this myosin HMM on the glass slide, and now they put this actin filament and they see how they move. In this experiment, they show when the number of density of this actin is less, there is an incoherent motion, and then they increase the density of this filaments and show that there is a very beautiful motion above the critical density where they form clusters for these actins, and when they increase more, they see beautiful flocking and this motion, density waves. So again, from that paper I have taken, and you can see this beautiful collective motion. So there are many systems in biology with biological relevance which would be performing this collective motion. And what is the relevance of that in biological action and so on, that is for you guys to figure out. Okay. So let me now come to the last part of this story, that what we have shown is, which is the very important key result, that a very small concentration of motile particles which were active have made, they carry coherently a large massive passive cargo, which are the beads. So, and that too, which this efficiency increases as you increase with load. So the question is this mutual interaction between motile and non-motile, is that having a relevance? And this is where Madan's critical comment to a journalist came in, and then I learned what he meant. So I'll just show for 1 minute what the idea could be. So this is the motivation. As I said, when the rods move, beads also become coherent. So question is there a biological analog? Maybe, maybe not. So this, let me show you what, these are the slides from Madan, and after talking to him, this is what I understand. So the idea is you look at active composite cell surface, which is really having all these dynamic actin filaments, long static actins and so on, and ask what happens to the molecules which are above this, which are so called immotile, non-motile. So the motility is coming only in the motors which are moving on this. Will they affect something happening outside? That is the analog of our experiments. And one such thing when they call active ones is, for example, integrin receptors, which are really coupled to this dynamic actin. There are other types of molecules which we will not worry in, but the idea which I understood from Madan is that if this is the integrin is like our non-motile, and the myosin motors are the motiles, and sure enough they show when there is a coupling, you can have beautiful arrangement of this integrin kind of things because something is happening below. So this is probably the closest analog I could understand, but there must be many, many more examples where the activity of one could be inducing something else which is so-called boring or the non-motile. Okay, so actually I am done with this part, and if you still have not fed up and don't want to beat me up, I'll tell you the last part of the story, with which I am very excited, because in the last few weeks I have done nothing except the last work, and we just communicated it yesterday. So I thought I'll just tell you, can you make an engine out of bacteria? That's the idea. So the idea is, can you make a heat engine which operates between bacterial baths? So what's the idea here? This idea is the following. This is a heat engine which you know for the last 200 years, more than 200 years. Carnot cycle, Stirling cycle, and so on. So what is the idea in that which we read in high school? The high school says that, look, you have some substance, working substance at a higher temperature, let's say, and you give the heat to this, it does some work for you and it cools down and goes to a cold bath. So you have a hot bath, you have a cold bath. And depending on this cold bath and hot bath, you can define the efficiency, Carnot efficiency, which depends on this ratio. Ideally, you would like it infinity, like T hot over T cold should be infinite, because then you will get the maximum efficiency. This is something extremely well known as called Carnot engine. Which is also there, which is parallel, where you have isotherms, it's called Stirling engine. And in Stirling engine, what you do, let me just take you through this, because this is what we will be using. Idea is very simple. You have a engine, you have first an isothermal expansion at a high temperature. This does work for you. That's how you move around things. This does work, you extract work. At this stage, you do from hot to cold, but keeping the volume same. It's called isochoric cooling. No work is done here. Now you come here, you do now the compression at the cold temperature. You do compression here, from here to here, and now you take back by isochoric heating back to this. So this is your Stirling cycle, and you can extract work out of it. This is what you know for the last 250 years. Question is, can you do this for a microscopic realization, which means 10 raised to power 23 gas molecules are replaced by one or two degrees of freedom? Answer is yes, which was shown in a very beautiful paper in 2011 by this group in Germany. What they showed was, replace this gas 10 raised to power 23 particles per centimeter cube just by a colloidal particle, one particle, and replace this piston by an optical tweezer. So optical tweezer is like a piston, and colloidal particle is like your gas molecule. 10 raised to power 23 is replaced by one. So they did exactly this analog in this beautiful work. Exactly what, when I say expansion, you change the trap stiffness and so on, and you do this, and they showed using stochastic thermodynamics. What is so critical here? Point is, now it's fluctuating quantity. Temperature is a fluctuating quantity because you have only one degree of freedom, not very less degree of freedom, not so many. But all your variables you replace by fluctuating variables, and that theory was used to estimate the work done and the efficiency. So this answer is known since 2011. I will not give you optical tweezer story, which all you all know. So what they have done is this. Now, this is the beautiful summary of this work. Those for non-experts, they're calling a Stirling effort, and indeed tongue-in-cheek, that what is the so critical about it. So here you have a macroscopic engine replaced by a microscopic engine, one particle, and they showed you can get work out of it and what is the efficiency. And they showed, okay, these are the equation which you use, I will not go in, but what do you measure here? Let me say half a second, because you will be very confused. The particle is in a trap, harmonic potential. Particle is doing motion. This motion, when it becomes shallow or at high temperature, becomes very different. Fluctuations are large. So the fluctuations in the displacement and the velocity of that particle is the one which we are analyzing in the framework of that stochastic thermodynamics to extract work and efficiency. This is what was shown in 2011. So let me cut the story short and tell you what we have done. So now here, what is so important is to realize that we still have a concept of temperature. We have temperature bath, which is what they did, water temperature, T hot, tea cold, and then they are varying the trap stiffness by the laser power. What we are asking is now, can you replace this reservoir by completely different? You can't even talk of temperature. You talk of activity. Lot of activity here, less activity here. Can you get an engine out of it? And that we do using bacteria. So we have bacteria now, which is what is written here. And this bacterial activity depends on the temperature of the bath. So temperature here is just to vary the activity. It's not really the control parameter. You can see this huge motion. And when it will be less temperature, you can see less activity. So you can vary the activity of this bacteria. You can culture them. This is what we did in collaboration with Professor Deepankar Chatterjee and his student. And we take out this bacteria at this point in the growth curve, and we vary the activity. We get various batches and we vary the activity of this bacteria. So here we are varying the activity by the temperature of the bath. So this experiment took about 2 years to do. Sudhish, what he did, he had two channels. In one, the water was flowing at different temperature. Other one, you had the bacteria and the colloidal particle, and you are trapping the colloidal particle. So trapping is still with colloidal particle. This bacteria is just heating it and producing lot of work, lot of fluctuation. So this is what is written. This is the actual experiment. We do all this isothermal expansion, isothermal compression, and you can see that the probability distribution for displacement is highly, highly non-Gaussian. Unlike a thermal reservoir, it's a beautifully Gaussian displacement. This comments are only for those who care about these distributions. And the fun is all in this non-Gaussian part. And on this scale, this is our engine for passive when the bacteria die and there is no activity. This is to scale. So this is the cycle when there are no bacteria or the bacteria are dead. And this is the actual cycle when the bacteria are active. So here you can see the bacterial temperature, the bath temperature varies from 313 to 290, just a very small variation. So this temperature has nothing to do with enhanced activity. So this is where we show, I'll just jump all the slides, we estimate this thing and shown that here you can't even define the temperature. There is a problem in the literature. People will say T effective, effective temperature, which if you use by using some Gaussian construct, really doesn't capture the whole story. And that numbers are extremely small. So on this, I show the work done per cycle of this heating. You can see on this scale, the passive engine is just here, which is expanded here. But now when we have this bacteria, it's a huge activity. It is actually two orders of magnitude higher. So this is something very interesting. Now we quantify why this is happening. And it's a fluctuating quantity because it is just stochastic. And the average is what we are talking. Efficiency is 40% and the efficiency of the passive engine is only 5%. So eight times increase. So let me cut this story short to show that all this activity is happening actually from the displacements which are not so well behaved, not in the Gaussian distribution. And we estimate that, which is almost 85% of the work, I will not go into detail, and show that really this is our efficiency versus activity temperature. You can see it increases and then saturates. And this is where if you done an effective Gaussian approximation, you will fail miserably and so on. And here the beauty is it can even enhance the theoretical limit on the passive cycle, because it has nothing to do with the passive cycle. So here we get a efficiency which is 40%, and this is what theoretical limit is on a passive cycle. So this construct, if you look at it, my idea was just to expose this paper. You can read tomorrow, it will appear on the CONMAT with all the details. What we have shown is that you can make a microscopic engine. You can take the concept which people did with the passive reservoir, but now put them in a non-thermal reservoir where you can't even talk of temperature. So this realize this with high power and efficiency, and majority of the performance arises from non-thermal, a non-Gaussian fluctuation. And now it has many, many beautiful take. Now you can have something in your system, any activity. It can be chemical imitator, it can be mechanical imitator, it can be anything. It can be Janus particles. And now you vary their activity with light or magnetic field, anything which you want to do, and you can make a engine out of it. And question is, can you use it in devices, in biological sense, and so on? That is for all you to do, not me. So this is something I'll just summarize. Apologies for few minutes of time I took more. Just to summarize that the first part of the talk was to relate to the active matter, where we showed that with this mechanical imitators, you can do so many nice things, so many beautiful experiments, and you just need an undergrad even to look at these, and many beautiful things. And the last part, which was like a trailer, not the full story, I didn't give you the details, that you can now make micro engines using these active particles, where the concept of this temperature, the so-called temperature, is not even defined. You have completely activity. So instead of isothermal, now we are calling isoactivity. So isothermal is replaced by isoactivity, and you can make an engine. So with this, I thank you once again for being with me for this 55 minutes, and I appreciate your patience. Thank you very much.
Questions?
Did you try using rubber particles or any polymer particles in the shaking thing?
No.
Because if you use a soft material, the transmission is killed, and many of biology is from soft, so how do you transmit?
So the point is, here, when you take those systems, you don't have to work with the vertical shaker. You can have other ways to induce activity. So this construct, which I said, is for mechanical objects which are being vibrated. But if you have polymer particles or some polymer spheres which people try, elongated ones and so on, you can have other means. You can have chemical means, or you can have some other ways to move
them. I meant the medium. The medium. The medium was a
So there is no medium. These are dry grains.
In the first part of the talk.
Correct. Dry grains. There is no medium.
Beads are the medium.
I apologize. No, we have not tried anything else.
So the communication is killed that
time. Yeah. So that's a more complicated question. How far the communication will go will definitely decide. So we have to see under that condition whether there will be talking enough, the rods, to form a collective state.
Because that's what happens.
Yeah. We have not tried.
What would be the efficiency of this engine, considering that there is no concept of temperature, because
so I showed we have reached. So what we do, I sorry for rushing through this. Our temperature of the bath is 310 Kelvin. But now I supposing you insist and you really are a, not a pest but insistent. You say define a temperature for me.
Reviewer.
So what we have done is. What we have already done, taking care of that nasty thing, we have the probability distribution of the displacement. We take the variance of that, put equal to half kbt, because that is what you would have said if you had this equipartition theorem and so on. That defines T activity, which we are calling T activity. This is a name concocted by us. That is actually 5000 Kelvin when the bacteria are active. So it's a huge temperature, and that is what we are saying in our work. It might be a way to even estimate the activity. When you say this bacteria is more active than this bacteria is more active than this, what is a quantitative measure? What is the standard? So what we are saying is maybe that is one way to quantify. You can talk in terms of efficiency and so on, as I showed you. The efficiency and work done depend on the T active, and then it saturates. So this is something what we are doing. Yeah.
So it's amazing how you showed the flocking as a.
Oh yeah.
So it's amazing how you showed flocking as a very fundamental process. I just want to know, is there any mechanism that you think or a hypothesis that you have? Is it a path of least resistance or some force, an equilibrium or non-equilibrium or what?
No, it is a non-equilibrium process. You are feeding each particle energy. When their density is high, and that is what the simplest V-check model showed, that what you just need are the, or not even V-check, the Reynolds model. What you need is the minimal model to show, look, when you look at your neighbor, just follow it, align it. That simple fact is enough. Now, in real life, it can be more complicated, which it is. In, if when you see the birds, they will do all this, you know, changing the leader and so on, and taking advantage of all the buoyancy effects and so on, so that when this fellow moves, the next people are eased in moving. So obviously there is energy saving, and all the living objects like human beings like to save energy, and they follow that.
But the initial path that is decided upon, how is that?
So initial thing, something does it, it's like starting, it's a transient state, and after a while it becomes collective. Yes.
Why is the distribution non-Gaussian?
It's a very deep question actually. We have, so what is happening is that when you have this active particles hitting to this colloidal particle, you can ask what is the statistics of displacement of this particle in the well. So which we have shown that actually it will be super diffusive, which is what was shown by in a paper here in EPL 2009 by I have not given the reference correctly, maybe it's right, and what we show is the mean square displacement versus time. You can see it is super diffusive, and then after some time it becomes slope 1. So this time has a very big relevance on what time scale we are cycling our system, and what is the length scale over which these things are happening. So we know the time scale in which particle experiences trapping potential, which is 100 hertz, and you can show, actually put all these things very, very quantitatively in a parameter which shows that if you have this parameter which has included this tau C and the trap stiffness and all that, if this is much less than 1, you can show it will be non-Gaussian. And if it is greater than 1, it will be Gaussian. So it depends. If we had really waited for not really too long, it wouldn't have been the case. So you have to be in the right cycling time and the trap stiffness to get this non-Gaussian thing. So it is quite a robust mechanism. And this is not our work actually. This was given by this theoretical understanding in this.
So you showed that beats are required for the flocking behavior of rods, but if you just remove the beats and keep on increasing the number of
it does rods. So it is a boring state, because what happens, even when you increase to 50-60%, still they are not feeling each other.
And 90%,
80%, you have to have a good student to do this. He got fed up. No, it doesn't help. Yeah.
At least in the simulation, if you go to 70% or something like
maybe
that, you get perfectly good flocks.
It will happen on some short time scales. It
less,
can
less interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. So now that I have the mic, can I ask a question that I've been trying to ask for?
Yeah, you have the mic.
About the non-Gaussian statistics, I was trying to figure out, is there some way of, you said you could extract numbers to show that most of the
85%
work. So how do you do that? How do you?
So what we do, we simulate. We have the actual P of X.
Yes.
And we know what statistics is outside this Gaussian.
Yeah.
So we extract the we calculate the work done from those displacements.
Yes.
And then estimate that. So it's done quantitatively from the P of X.
But in that case, if it had been just Gaussian, I think there's no way of distinguishing this from an equilibrium thermal system,
okay.
And so you should extract.
Sure. Answer is yes. Very good question.
At this funny temperature.
Okay. So what happens is, if it was totally Gaussian, we would be able to define T effective, and that time the effect may not be that large. In fact, there is a plot which I skipped here. So this is the effective temperature, which itself is much higher than 313 Kelvin. But that one, you can see, contributes very little. So, so the moral of the whole story is, if I can again say it at the risk of being repetitive, the fun is in not having a T effective, and fun is in having non-Gaussian statistics, which are the rare events. Why it is doing more work? Somebody can ask. Because these are huge excursions of the particle displacement, and they are doing all the work. And that's why the efficiency work done is more. And if they were T, and so what we do, we also do T variance. We said, okay, let's do the best. We know the experimental variance. We construct a theoretical Gaussian, and even that does not capture everything. So even now you have these events, which are really the outliers, which do all the work, not out the work, a majority of the work. So this is something which is the message from this graph. Yeah, please.
I see that in all the cases where there is collective behavior, the rods mostly move around along the walls of the container. So have you tried to play around with the frequencies or the geometry of the container?
That's what somebody asked earlier also. So in this circular geometry, they go in a circle. But I also showed a simulation of periodic boundary condition where there is no shape. And there they have the collective motion, not in a circle, but in a one direction.
But have you seen any other kind of patterns?
No. We have not, no. Sorry. We have only done two types of systems. One, this butterfly in this thing, and another in this horse track where we see the swarming. So these are the only two things we have seen. In swarming, which are below the order disorder line, they again form beautiful motion, collective state, but not everything. They form this and they keep on moving. They break, move. So beautiful things happen in this whole phase diagram. So if you change the shape, you can make rectangle because imagination has no limit. You can do anything. Question is, if they get stuck at the corner, it's a bad sign. It's a failed experiment. So you don't want that. But other than that, you can do whatever you want.
Have you tried to change the frequency of vibration?
Okay. I probably said it too fast. I apologize. What you vary is gamma, which is amplitude times frequency square divided by gravitational acceleration. So you can play with amplitude and omega square in any way you want. What matters is gamma. But if there is another variable coming, we have not explored. We have only explored this dimensionless variable.
Okay, we'll have a last question from Aprutham.
Yeah, I'm still just trying to understand the last bit. How does T effective relate to the real temperature? So the real temperature, shall we say, varies from 17 degrees Celsius to 40 degrees Celsius, which is, but the behavior of the bacteria obviously change very non-linearly as this temperature
changes. So temperature of the bath is just very incidental. It was just used, the 20 degrees, to change the bacterial activity. If you have any other way, you can make them active. This temperature even need not change. It can be fixed temperature, and that is perhaps I said it, but I may not have said so clearly. What you need is isoactivity. You need one activity to another activity. And this has never been used, this concept. So I'm not sure how we'll be beaten up, but till the referee reports come, we are still strong.
I'm just saying at 17 degrees Celsius, say all transcription is nearly stopped, and at 40 degrees Celsius,
yeah,
they're just...
So you can have stopped. Any activity parameter.
Yeah.
This is our temperature in our case is just a facilitator.
Right.
Let me say it again. If you have ultraviolet light, and if you can give me some cells which obey the ultraviolet light, it will do that. And that's what we are conjecturing, that anything which will change the activity is good for us. We don't need temperature. So that is why we are not even calling it isothermal. We are calling it isoactive. So that's the change which we hope time will tell whether it is correct or not.
Okay, I think I can see that there's a lot more people who would like to ask questions, but I think we'll call a stop to the formal question session. And informal questions, Professor Sood is going to be around for a little while. and you can flock around. Thank you very much.